Good morning and a very warm welcome to the second meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. Our first agenda item today is budget scrutiny. On the 9th of December, the Scottish Government published the Scottish Budget for 22-23. This morning we will take evidence on the budget in relation to recommendations made in the committee's pre-budget scrutiny report. And a welcome to committee this morning, Angus Robertson, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, Scott Whiteman, Director of External Affairs for the Scottish Government, and Bettina Sisland, Deputy Director for Tourism and Major Events in the Scottish Government. And I welcome you all this morning, and Cabinet Secretary, can I invite you to make a brief opening statement?
Convener, belated Happy New Year to you and all other committee members. It's a pleasure to have the opportunity to appear before the committee. I think it's the fourth time since my appointment, and on this occasion just working scrutinising the government's proposed budget for my portfolio area for 2022-23. At £370.5 million, budget for Constitution, External Affairs, Culture represents less than 0.7% of the Scottish Government's budget, and it is excellent value for money. Committee members are well aware of the fiscal pressures resulting from COVID and the impacts of Brexit. But despite those, my budget will increase by £21.7 million the next financial year, and that will enable us to fully fund, amongst other things, the 2022 census at £3.3 million. It gives me the opportunity early in the session to put on record my appreciation to my Cabinet Secretary colleague Kate Forbes, as well as the First Minister and other Cabinet colleagues, who during the recent budgetary process were extremely supportive of protecting the position, especially of culture, in the budget round. And what at the beginning might have seemed a real challenge to protect our spending on culture, I am content that we've managed to secure an excellent deal for the area of Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, which we'll go into in some greater detail with your questions. Just some headline figures for the committee's benefit. We're investing £277 million in culture and heritage in 22-23. That includes an increase of £13.7 million in funding to ensure that Historic Environment Scotland can continue to protect and care for our heritage and communities. We're continuing to support Scotland's regularly funded organisations, including providing £6.6 million in additional funding to enable Creative Scotland to maintain support for the regular funding programme. That's in the face of a significant decline in lottery receipts. We're also providing £9.25 million for Screen Scotland, which is an increase of £750,000. We will, during the next financial year, be expanding our network of international offices by opening a new Scottish Government office in Copenhagen, increasing opportunities for policy exchange for Scotland's economic and cultural visibility in the Nordic region. We'll be supporting EU citizens to ensure that those who've chosen to make Scotland their home can do so. We will be investing £18.2 million in major events and themed years, including £9 million to enable Scotland to host the first ever Cycling World Championships in 2023. And the pre-budget scrutiny from the committee has highlighted the importance of a strong cultural recovery from the pandemic. So I'm pleased to be able to confirm to the committee that we are directing our spend to protect and maintain existing cultural provision, including continued support for Scotland's regularly funded organisations, for the Scottish Libraries Information Council, Museums, Galleries Scotland and five national performing companies. We'll increase the International Development Fund by £1.5 million as a first step towards the commitment in the programme for government, increase the fund from £10 to £15 million during this Parliament, and that at a time when the UK government has slashed its international development budget by a third. Convener, the Finance Secretary and I are acutely conscious of the impact that that COVID has had on the cultural and major events sector. That's why we're committing an additional £65 million this financial year in support for the culture and events sector due to the impact, physical distancing and caps on attendance. and this is despite the continuing uncertainty over whether the UK Treasury will transfer the outstanding culture consequentials as it should. The budget for 22-23 will enable us to continue to support the sector's recovery. The budgets for major events and external affairs will also contribute to recovery from COVID, transition, net zero, and to delivering on our commitment that Scotland will be a good global citizen. I know that in your committee papers and in the letter that I wrote to you and committee members, I outlined a lot of the headline numbers. What has emerged since then has been the £65 million funding support package, which I'm happy to go into greater detail, but I think committee members are aware of the breakdown of the funds, on which point I will end, but it's, I think it's important to put on record that £31.5 million additional support is going to cultural businesses, organisations, venues and independent cinema support. £10 million is going to creative freelancers, £19.8 million to support the event sector, £2 million for the national performing companies. This is for Christmas losses, the touring fund repurpose, £1.7 million for museums, galleries and heritage. That's over and above previously announced commitments, and I'm sure colleagues will want to know about the dispersal of the funds and the speed of how that's all happening. Happy to follow up with greater detail. And where I don't have the information to hand, I'm delighted to be joined, as you mentioned, Convener, by Bettina Sizeland and Scott Whiteman. And if between the three of us we're not in a position to answer immediately, of course, we will be happy to reply in writing to any specific questions that we don't have the answer immediately to hand. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. It certainly seems a happier new year, knowing that indoor events are due to continue in Scotland from next week, and we can see the culture sector starting to recover a little bit. So thank you very much for that. If I could open with a question about the mainstreaming of culture, which was a main thrust of our pre-budget report. Before Christmas, you said that you were starting a series of conversations with Cabinet colleagues to identify areas of joint collaboration and to inform the multi-year resource spending review. I wonder if you're able to update us on that and let us know of any outcomes we may that may be forthcoming.
Well, it's a very timely question, Convener, because in recent weeks, this is indeed what I've been spending quite a lot of my time on. The background to this, of course, is the commitment by the First Minister in the culture strategy for Scotland, that culture is a cross-government priority. It's one for all ministerial portfolios in the Scottish Government that we all have to contribute towards. It's something that you, as your previous committee in 2019, also drew in attention to. And in a recovery strategy that I proposed to the Scottish Government Cabinet in November, at the heart of that was an agreement across government by all cabinet secretaries that we should be working together to mainstream the importance of culture in our recovery from COVID. So to make good on that principle and that commitment, during the last week or so, I've met with the cabinet secretaries for finance and the economy, net zero, for health and social care, and for education and skills, together with officials from our directorates, to begin this process, discussing ahead of the spending review later this year about how we can work together to deliver joined up cross-government responses to supporting culture and recovery from the pandemic, way that can accelerate progress against all of the national outcomes. And I should say we are being very mindful that cultural recovery is not something that is top down. That is something simply for the Scottish Government to come up with ideas and for that to trickle down. That's not the approach that we're taking. Yesterday, for example, was involved in discussions about the partnership with local government, for example, with government agencies that have responsibility in the culture scene, Creative Scotland, Screen Scotland, and so on. And then, really critically, for particularly in areas like health, is the voluntary sector. And so we've initiated the conversations. We have also, in addition to this work, we have the National Partnership for Culture, which has existed for some time, which brings in practitioners, people on the front line in the cultural world. They've been meeting throughout the pandemic, and we're looking forward to having their recommendations early this year, which will help inform the process that you've drawn attention to. I think it's going to be really, really important that we do everything that we can to prioritise culture as playing a role in all that government does, and at the very same time as we try to recover from the pandemic, marshal all the resources that we've got, material and otherwise, not all about money, although money is important, to make sure that we can help the culture and arts scene recover and bounce back as strongly as I know everybody on the committee is, you know, massively committed to the cultural sector, and you know, it's going to be a team effort that helps us do that. But in terms of government, we are beginning this process that I mentioned in my previous evidence session to the committee, and now that we're fingers crossed coming out from underneath the COVID cloud, we're going to be able to accelerate a lot of that in the months ahead.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And now move to questions from committee members, and could I invite Dr. Allen, please?
Thank you very much, and welcome again to the committee, Cabinet Secretary. I think we've spoken in the past, or certainly the committee has taken an interest in the past, in the issue of mainstreaming cultural spend, and I just wonder if you can say any more about what you've managed to do on that front in terms of interesting other parts of government and the public sector in the importance of culture. I'm thinking, for example, particularly the NHS and of town planning, and whether you've been able to advance the arguments that this is spending to save in the longer term in many other areas.
Well, I think the good news is that I've yet to come across anybody who doesn't appreciate the opportunity that we have in this area. So I've not picked up any institutional or intellectual resistance to the notion that culture in its broadest sense can have a transformative impact in different parts of the work of government. In the conversations that I've had with Cabinet Secretary colleagues, they have been the first to volunteer that, whether it's in terms of prescribing in the national health, talking about physical, but also very importantly mental health, if we're talking about education, value that culture can bring in its broadest of senses, and we know how much weight the Scottish Government has put on supporting, for example, music and hard-to-reach communities, with the likes of Sistema, who have just had increased funding from the Scottish Government, are able to reach into communities. So I think what's really encouraging is we're not doing this from a standing start. We're not doing this from a position of having to persuade anybody that this is worthwhile doing. What we are having to do, though, is do something that maybe doesn't come easily to government anywhere, which is how do you make the different bits of government work optimally together and bring everybody together, as I mentioned in my previous answer to the convener, around the other important actors out there who are already doing great things. There are some amazing things happening at a local government level. There are some great things that are happening in the voluntary sector. And one area, and I think I mentioned this in a previous evidence session, was where are their best examples? Because this isn't, you know, it's not just in Scotland that's thinking about doing all of these things. This has already been thought about in other countries as well. And I'm really, really keen to learn how does that work in other countries? How are they managing to deliver? There may be examples where they're further down the track or further behind. But I'm really keen that we can work together. And that's one of my priorities for this year, is using the convening power and the events that already take place, the Culture Summit, for example, that's taking place in Scotland this year, coming, the ability to meet face-to-face and not just in online conversations with colleagues. Within the last few weeks, I was speaking with my French opposite number, the French Culture Minister. We were talking about these areas of culture recovery as well. So it's how do we get best practice from other places that are doing it as well, and then it's about getting on with it. But as I say, a lot of this is happening already. It's just how do we scale it up? How do we make it deliver across government? And everything that I've heard so far from colleagues is that they are enthusiastic about it. And it's just a case of harnessing the best ideas and delivering as widely as we can so the benefits are felt right across Scotland.
Thank you. You've also mentioned the challenges that obviously the culture sector has faced throughout COVID. And I wonder, have those challenges changed? At an earlier stage, this committee would have been hearing about how to shift much of the culture sector online and to do things in a different way. And of course, perhaps now the demand is how to move things back offline again and how to get people back into events and live performances. Does the budget have to be agile enough to cope with that changing situation? And if so, how does it manage those changing priorities around culture coming through COVID?
Well, I think the most immediate response, and we have shown ourselves to be agile, is how did we manage during this latest Omicron variant and the impact that it had on the cultural and arts sector in Scotland, which was, you know, possibly the worst time of the year for many of them, December being a really important month for many. The Scottish Government worked extremely hard, firstly, to find the resources and the scale of the resources that were required for both the Scottish Government and for Creative Scotland in particular to be agile enough to work out how can we disperse the funds as quickly as possible with the due diligence that everybody would expect and we need to have when dispersing taxpayers' money on this scale. We're in the process of doing that right now, and it gives me the opportunity to put on record my appreciation, because a lot of this happened during the festive period, where civil servants in the Scottish Government and officials in Creative Scotland were burning the midnight oil and have continued to do so to make sure that our creative sector, the events, the venues, are able to remain solvent and are not losing out without support, so that as we begin to see things reopen, that they are in a position to reopen. And that's why we have had these different funding pots to try and make sure that we're reaching the whole part of the affected cultural sector in Scotland. We've got the cancellation fund for cultural organisations, and you know that's £31.5 million was allocated towards that. That is opening for applications on the 26th of January. The guidelines for the fund were published yesterday, if there are any organisations that are having sort of immediate solvency issues, Creative Scotland is prioritising those on an organisational or on a personal level. We were responsive to concerns in the cultural community about the position of freelancers, many of whom do not make a lot of money, but a significant number would be losing out because of the public health safeguards that were initiated over the festive period. That opened up on the 6th of January, the fund for those. And as of close of play yesterday, there have been 1,728 applications for that fund, totaling £2.95 million. Might interest committee members that the majority of those applications were from music freelancers, more than 60%. And Creative Scotland has so far paid out just over £1 million to 602 of the applications received. And I think that underlines the speed with which one has tried to allocate the funding as soon as it has been made available. In addition to that, there's the event sector, for which £19.8 million has been made available. Event Scotland is going to be dealing directly with the relevant businesses, because we know who they are because of previous funding challenges. Then in addition, there's the National Performing Companies who are receiving £2 million, and museums and galleries at £1.7 million. So you asked Dr. Allen about the ability to be responsive. The Scottish Government has been extremely responsive. We have had an excellent collaborative relationship with the creative and arts sector. We've been meeting all the time to discuss their needs, their interests, concerns and expectations, and how this can be delivered on as quickly as possible. And as you say, there is a sort of curiosity, isn't there, about in the past seeking to support arts and culture getting online and embracing, you know, the new technologies to make their art available for as many people as possible. And now we're just yearning to get back to theatres and galleries and cinemas and all the rest of it. So we're just having to go with the circumstances that we find ourselves in. And we're also, we have it's a slight dichotomy, isn't it? We are now, as we emerge from a period where we're telling people, please act responsibly in relation to the pandemic, of trying to give people confidence to go back to public spaces. And that's going to be one of the challenges that we have in the weeks and the months ahead, to help people have the confidence to be able to go back to theatres, cinemas, gigs, you name it. But I'm confident, knowing what I've heard from people involved in the sector, they are very, very alive to all of that. So if anybody needs any encouragement, please let's do what we can to help encourage people to attend events so that they can bounce back from the pandemic.
And finally, Convener, you also mentioned, Cabinet Secretary, that one of the challenges that you are facing was trying to establish the UK government's intentions around consequentials in this area. Can you say a bit more about that and how it's affecting what you're doing?
Well, I can answer that on two levels. One, we keep on asking the UK government, where are the consequentials in it? I mean, I'm not entirely sure, you know, what the rationale is in the Treasury or on Whitehall on not being clear and delivering on what is supposed to be delivered on. And we'll continue to press that point, and we'll continue to encourage those who have any influence over the Treasury to do so. But in the meantime, we've had to get on with finding the resources, deal with the scale of the challenge that we've got. So we've got a twin-track approach, one of which is to try and get the Treasury to deliver on its consequentials, and two, we're just having to do what we can do within the limited powers of devolution, and that's exactly what we have done. But I don't know if your committee or others are ever going to be taking evidence from UK government ministers who have any responsibility for consequentials. I would be delighted to learn why it is that it takes months and months and months to have any clarity whatsoever on what's happening. I'd like to hear the answer to that. I haven't heard it yet.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from Mr. Ruskell to be followed by Ms. Boyack. Thanks.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. So I think, you know, this year's budget remains pretty challenging for local government, and, you know, we know the reasons why that's the case. And I think particularly in the area of discretionary spend, it's difficult to see how councils are not going to be looking at how they can make savings. And I hope those don't fall in the culture sector, but there's a risk that they do. I was wondering to what extent you've discussed that with Shona Robertson and Ben McPherson. And I suppose the flip side, the good news of this budget, is that it will result in increased funding for local government, particularly in areas such as health, social care, education. So do you see any immediate opportunities in the next year for mainstreaming some of the excellent work the cultural organisations do to support health, mental health, wellbeing, for example, through that increased budget? Or is that increase of that budget effectively allocated to other priorities which are not immediately going to be available for cultural organisations who are doing that important work in terms of wellbeing?
Well, I think your question underlines both the opportunity and the challenge of getting this right, because there are a number of actors involved in it. And my colleague Jenny Gilruth, if memory serves me correctly, in December held meetings with local government colleagues on cultural questions. And as we go forward with the developing of these plans that we're discussing within government, is to do those in partnership with colleagues in local government, and with the voluntary sector. I'm not wanting to prejudge that. I've yet to meet people in local government who don't wish for the cultural sector in their part of Scotland to do badly, or don't get the advantages that culture can bring for the services that they provide in many cases. So, but I think it is true to say that there are nuances and differences between local government in different parts of the country, and that, you know, then opens up the question of local democracy and priorities versus centralised top-down direction on priorities. And that's why I'm keen to try and make sure that we have as much buy-in and common ownership of all of this. And yes, money is very important. Yes, planning and frameworks and priorities and all of that's very important. But I would also like to draw attention to the myriad of third sector organisations who in many ways will be at the front line, particularly in the point you raise, and I know you've raised this in previous meetings as well, Mr. Ruth. I know this is important for you in terms of the prescribing element. Much of that, you have to imagine, will be recommendations for people to take part in services that are provided by voluntary organisations. Not even by local government or by the Scottish Government or anybody else. It will be local groups at a community level who do all kinds of things that people, if they were able to take part, it would help with mental health challenges and so on. So, again, not wanting to prejudge this, but I think working together with both umbrella organisations for the voluntary sector, the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, any local government areas or voluntary organisations who have a particular locus and experience in all of this, I think by working together, we will be able to build an approach to this which gets maximum value out of this. And this also happens at a time of cultural change. So how do we make sure that there is early adoption for these as pathways to treatment, and I don't know how long that will take. This will be new for many who will be prescribing these services, but we want to be able to give them the maximum assurance and reassurance that what they are referring to will have the beneficial advantages that we think they will do. But I finish where I start. I have yet to have a conversation with anybody at any level who gives me the feeling that they're not keen to try and make this work.
I think everybody knows it's a good idea, right? But it's how to pin that down into, you know, long-term core budgets that are not necessarily coming out of discretionary spend, which councils are struggling with at the moment. So I think that's the bit I'm interested in. I'm wondering to what extent the National Partnership for Culture is really looking in depth at this type of funding. I mean, I noticed that, you know, you've got NHS 24 on the partnership, and I'm sure that's welcome. But, you know, where is the discussion with Health and Social Care Partnerships or COSLA about absolutely nailing this to make sure that, you know, where government is prepared to increase investment in councils under very difficult circumstances, I understand that. But where we are prepared to really invest in local government in a way that is, you could call it, ring fence, how do we make sure that the value of that really is being shared with the cultural sector and the cultural sector is able to deliver on those objectives? Because it just feels like, you know, we always think it's a great idea, but, oh, we don't know how it's actually going to work in terms of core funding.
Yeah. Well, you've put your finger in one of the areas where either we'll get that right and we will succeed, or we don't, and, you know, we'll be back here in a year or 5 years' time talking about how we're not quite there yet. So I can't prejudge that, and I don't want to prejudge that, but I do acknowledge entirely that the point that you're making is at the heart of being able to deliver across Scotland. Because, I mean, if there is a danger, it's that there would be different council areas who, because of the priorities that they set, decide that this isn't a priority for them. And then you might find that in some parts of the country, you're seeing excellent pathways and the prescribing of services in this area, but not in others. And you know, that would be a great shame. Having said that, I happen to think that when people see that this is happening and it is best practice and it does fit within budgets, that I think people will realise the value of it, and if they don't do it already, they will be persuaded that they should be getting on with it. So I think a mixture of pull and push, carrot and, you know, I don't want to put stick up in lights, because I just think, I think it is such a good idea that if we can, working in partnership with the organisations that you and I have both identified, that between us all, we should be able to begin the process of this taking place. And by keeping us all on our toes, as the likes of yourselves as a committee will be doing, you will make sure that this gets out of discussions and strategies and frameworks and policies, and is actually delivered on the ground so that people are having the benefit of the things that we know will make a benefit to people's lives.
Okay, here's hoping. Can I ask you just another couple of specifics then? I mean, around the budget. I mean, one is about Historic Environment Scotland. I mean, obviously, you know, challenging in terms of, you know, reduction visits that's happening at the moment. I mean, hopefully that's going to recover. But I'm wondering if there's any projections for how that's going to recover. A bit of crystal ball perhaps required there. The second question was really just about the opening of the Copenhagen office, which you mentioned in your introductory remarks, and just how that's progressing. I noticed the budget's been allocated for the next year for that. Could we expect to see an office open this year? Are there any details you can share at this point, which I think is going to be a great...
I'll start off with Historic Environment Scotland, and I'll give Scott Whiteman, who's on this call, the heads up that I'm about to... I'm going to ask him to add on to my contribution, because I know we were talking about this yesterday, about what is how things are actually progressing. So I'll say what I have to say about it, and he'll add some more detail on that. But to the first part of your question on Historic Environment Scotland, in budgetary terms, we are providing £70.1 million for Historic Environment Scotland, which is an increase of £14.2 million on this financial year. And £60.6 million of that is a resource allocation, £3 million for depreciation, £6.5 million for capital funding. And the reason why, and I think most people in the committee are aware of this, the reason why this uplift has been required, although we shouldn't take it for granted, because, you know, at one stage we were looking at the potential of budgets being squeezed, but we have managed to secure an uplift for the budget because of the drastic reduction in commercial income for Historic Environment as a result of the pandemic. And essentially what that means is we haven't been able to go out for many periods over the last few years, so we haven't been able to visit the properties that Historic Environment Scotland has responsibility for, so they haven't been getting the income. Now, you asked, do I have a crystal ball? Well, I have the crystal ball in terms of what is Scottish Government funding. What I don't have a crystal ball for is the public response to the opportunity to revisit or to visit after the reopening of facilities. And here is something that I'm very keen that we can do the most that we can do, which is to encourage people to support cultural organisations in the broadest of senses, but specifically those areas which have been exceptionally challenged, and Historic Environment Scotland is one of them. So if I can use the platform of the committee to appeal to anybody who is interested in culture and heritage, please sign up, please go, please visit. When you have weekend opportunities or days off, take the family, and by going and by paying to visit sites, we will be doing everything that we can to help Historic Environment Scotland find its feet again, and you know, that is the crystal ball that I can't make any accurate predictions on, but it will take time, and so I think we're going to have to do the best that we can possibly do to help Historic Environment Scotland recover, and that is what we're going to do. Now, on On Copenhagen, this is a new budget line in our budgeting for the next financial year, because we're setting up an office in Copenhagen in the spring of 22. So that is this year. We have an indicative budget of £598,000, which includes a contribution of £148,000 towards corporate running costs. And once staff are appointed and the office is open, we'll be clearer on the full year running costs required for the location. I'm hugely encouraged about having an office in Copenhagen. I think having a direct link in Northern Europe is a great thing. And I think for culture in particular, and it's a point that I've made to the committee before, I think there are great things that we can learn in particular from Denmark when it comes to public service broadcasting and their screen and television sector. And that's one of my hopes, that the office in Copenhagen will help us in our transformational situation in Scotland for film and production. So yes, the Copenhagen Scotland House will be opening this year. Yes, we've allocated budget for it. Scott Whiteman, is there anything that you want to add to what I've said for Mr. Ruskell?
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just perhaps one additional point, that we're in the process at the moment of appointing the head of the office, so that the recruitment exercises is underway and should be completed very shortly. I expect we'll be in a position to formalise the appointment very soon.
Excellent. Thanks very much. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. I'm going to move to questions from Ms. Boyack, to be followed by Mr. Golden.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to focus on the challenge of recovery, which you've mentioned a couple of times in your comments, and the importance of enabling people to access culture in terms of the health and mental well-being that we need, and it's also part of who we are. And focusing on the challenge of recovery, particularly, I think, as you acknowledged in your opening remarks about effectively not being able to have Christmas and Ogmanay, which for many venues and for many cultural organisations is a key income generator. So I'm wondering if you could say a bit more about that, in particular the issue of retaining people in the sector. I've certainly had casework and people getting in touch who've either left the sector because they can't afford it because of the bills, or because of the uncertain nature of funding. And I'd like to link that into the community side of culture, because we had some really good examples at the cross-party group we have on culture and communities last night, where with individual projects employing people locally in the cultural sector and giving them that opportunity of much more certainty in terms of income generation. So I was wondering if you could focus that in terms of retaining people in the sector, but also changing the way that people work to give them the opportunity of more work in communities, and how we could actually bring that about. I'd just like some initial thoughts on that from the Cabinet Secretary.
We could probably discuss this for the whole of the evidence session, Ms. Boyack. It's hugely important. Well, the first point relates at the moment in terms of my thinking about the financial support package that we have secured, and making sure that covers all of the areas of where there has been a financial loss in the culture and arts sector. That's not the same thing as saying one will be able to cover every single lost bit of income. But because of the scale of the funding that has been secured and the way in which the funds have been constructed, it is being constructed in a way that is trying to have the maximum impact on people, whether they have a smaller income or whether they're larger organized significant outgoings, especially during this last lockdown, and we're going to lose a lot. Now, one of the things that I've been keen to stress to officials through this whole process is the requirement, as I see it, for us to have flex in our funding response to this problem. So to give you an example, the £10 million allocation towards freelancer funding, and again, I use the opportunity with a public audience to say to anybody out there who feels that they and knows that they lost money and they work in the cultural and art sector, please make sure that you apply for the funding, because it will make a difference to your financial situation. And it's also for the reasons that Ms. Boyack said. We are not wanting to lose people from the cultural sector for whom it has become increasingly difficult for them to make financial ends meet. So, going back to the flex point, we have a number of limits on spending allocations, and freelancers, it's been £2,000. I've said that if we have gone through the initial funding allocation round, and I gave the numbers at the beginning of the evidence session about how many applications there had been and how much there has been dispersed, but if we find that we have resource within these particular funds, that we, if we can, should be in a position to act sympathetically towards further loss that people may have had. So what I'm trying to say to Ms. Boyack and other committee members is I am absolutely seized on us making sure we do everything we possibly can to deal with people's personal or business financial loss in the cultural and arts sector, point one. Point two, I acknowledge that the whole period of COVID lockdowns has had a hugely detrimental impact on a lot of people's, I'm talking not in general terms because we know about that, but specifically in culture and the arts, to people on low incomes, to the people who are just at the start of their career. And, you know, it's always difficult to start to establish oneself in the cultural scene. The difficulty, the absence of the ability to tour, the impact that Brexit has had on people's ability to tour on the continent, and as we know, there are a great many Scottish artists who, for whom that is where they are most successful. Now, not all of that is solved by funding support mechanisms for, you know, the COVID circumstances that we found ourselves in. So there are other things that we are going to need to look at and are looking at to support touring arrangements. Is a good example of that, working with the music sector on that, and other areas to make sure that as we recover, that people who might have been beginning to think, I don't think this is sustainable, I don't think I can carry on, get the feeling that there is support out there for them to get back into the cultural sector and to hopefully establish themselves. There are, incidentally, there are also some straws in the wind about changing visa arrangements, for example, and you know, countries like Spain are live to the challenges that we've been stressing with them that have come about through Brexit. So that's my answer to the first part of Ms. Boyack's question. Happy to come back on any of that. On the second part of people wanting to go into the culture sector and wanting to start doing constructive things at a community level, well, this is why I'm so pleased that we've been able to secure the funding allocation in culture that we had in previous years. So through organisations like Creative Scotland, that the funds are there for a whole series of different projects that deliver in different ways. Now, I'm happy to write to Ms. Boyack about those on a community level, but this is where there is crossover with Mr. Ruskell's earlier point about local government and community workers, community outreach workers, where there is a crossover with culture and with the voluntary sector. And we know that that works very well in some places, and in some places it is less established. And that is one of the areas for me where this cultural recovery process and working with local government and working with the voluntary sector,
I think we'll get a much better handle on what will be a mixed picture throughout Scotland, and try and establish it with, you know, as much support as we possibly can, so the whole of Scotland has the benefit of it.
Yeah, I think I would be interested in that follow-up offer of information that you just gave me there, Cabinet Secretary, about culture and communities. I mean, one of the things that is really striking, it's to follow on from Mark Ruckel's point, is culture isn't a requirement, but actually it's critical to people's health and wellbeing and to our communities. So having that funding available at local level is absolutely critical, and we've taken evidence in the committee on that before. And the benefits to people are absolutely critical. So it's to come back to that point about health prescribing. We've had some very good evidence presented directly. Art and Healthcare came to Parliament before Christmas. There's the work that was done in different communities to support people through the pandemic. But as we recover, that work will need to continue. So it's not a tick the box, move on. It's how did the experience of those community projects, which actually have helped employ artists and people in the cultural sector, but have critically supported communities, how do we increase that? And then as we're living in an era where inflation is rocketing, how do we support people to afford to access culture? I saw an excellent paper from Scottish Opera which showed what they're doing in terms of touring around the country, and Festival Fringe is attempting to encourage people to get into the festival or to take the Festival Fringe out to them. But going forward, that affordability for culture is going to be absolutely massive. So in practical terms, what's going to be available for community groups and councils to make sure that the venues are there and we can actually see that happening going forward?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Everything you say there is on the money with what is needing to happen. Now, as you point out, there's some really, really good examples, and they're not the only ones. You know, about harder to reach communities, about younger people who might live in more peripheral areas being able to take part in the cultural offering. But it's then also about culture not just taking place where certain venues are. It is in bigger cities, for example. It is about getting out and getting to different parts of Scotland, Scottish Opera, but the other national performing companies too, and the funding being there for others to get to right across Scotland. So, you know, that point one, absolutely, it can't just be happening in some isolated parts of the country that are particularly well served by cultural infrastructure. Point two about affordability. I think we all are aware now about what is going on with the level of inflation, need to be alive to the fact about how disproportionate the cost for certain things might be for people, which would put them off attending cultural events. I know that many of the cultural organisations are extremely alive to all of this. You mentioned the Festival Fringe. There's a lot of work, it's a really good example, a lot of work that goes on there in terms of reaching different parts of the city, different social demographic groups, having different approaches to admission. We need to encourage the best practice from somewhere like that is shared right across the cultural sector. And, you know, this is going to be a constant challenge to try and make sure that it can deliver. I never tire of saying to my officials and people in the cultural sector that I am very keen to learn about best practice, whether that's best practice here. So I'll be very keen for my officials to learn the lessons from the evidence that you've heard as a committee, written and oral. I'm very keen that we do that, but I'm also very keen to learn what are other countries doing at the present time? What are the policies that they are doing that are innovative, that deal with access, that deal with cross-government experience, that deal with protecting people coming into the cultural sector as well? We don't have a monopoly of common sense or good ideas. And wherever those might be, I'm keen that we road test whether those are applicable here as well. And so again, if as part of your work in the committee, and I said this from the outset, I'm very keen to have collaborative working approach with yourselves. If you're taking evidence and learning about things, I'm very keen that we hear and see those and make sure that that influences our thinking and what we do as government, working together with yourselves doing the job that you do in the committee.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I think particularly the health prescribing issue, there is innovation in the rest of the UK that we are that we could definitely learn from, that would actually retain people in the sector but also make that impact in the communities that we're all after. So I think quite an appetite for hearing more about that going forward and about looking for innovation. And if the committee convener will indulge me, I had one final question. I noted the national events in the budget in your letter, and you've highlighted the UCI cycling event that's happening next year. £9 or £10 million, any chance of getting that mainstreamed into the budget so that some of the things you've just been talking about health prescribing, we could actually have the resources when the policy gets developed?
So I'm going to give Bettina Sizeland a heads up to follow up on the question that you've asked, so she can put a little bit more detail into the generality that I'm about to share with you. Of all of the things that have crossed my desk since becoming Cabinet Secretary, especially in the event space, the scale and opportunity from the World Cycling Championships is the one that is so striking in its scale and the potential that it offers. Not just because people will be able to attend and see high-level cycling events right across the gamut of different cycling sports, or the fact that the venues are right across Scotland, which is a good thing, but it provides an opportunity for a cultural change as well in terms of how we see cycling as a mode of transport and of living, and by extension health as well. And I think you're absolutely right to ask a question of what is the net benefit of this above and beyond the core parts of the championship itself. And in the I chaired a cabinet meeting of the Cycling World Championships, where there was extensive discussion about all of this and of making sure that the benefits of an event like this are not just for the period of the event, and that they reach into, you know, the entire country. So I think it would probably be helpful for you and colleagues to have people from the organising side of the event to let you know about all of that, because it certainly impressed me. In terms of the budgetary allocation for the event, Bettina comes from the event side of things of the Scottish Government, and she can probably fill in. And if there's anything around, you know, which budget line this is allocated from has a practical impact on any of that, I'm happy to learn what that might be. My experience, I think, is, you know, effectively we have a third party organisation that is delivering the event. The dispersal of funds is their responsibility. Now, of course, there's an oversight role to be played here, and that's why I go back to the point of it's something that the committee may want to have a direct interest in, so that you can learn about that. But Bettina, if I can hand over to you, and you can share insights that you might have about the budgetary side of the World Cycling Championship.
Of course. Mr. Robertson, good morning, everybody. I think the first thing to say about UCI 2023 Cycling World Championships is that it is a unique event. It's the first of its kind. It's going to have huge international profile and reach. I think that's a given, seeing that we will be bringing 13 international global championships together for the first time in Glasgow. The other aspect to this is that it's been designed very much with policy at its centre. So this is about using the event as a platform for some of the other activity that's going on within Scottish Government. So it's a very good example of cross-government working, because it's a platform for the active travel promotion of that, the support of that, to ensure that, you know, in terms of health and well-being, it really gets people excited about the event, excited about walking, cycling and active travel, and having opportunities in their local areas to develop that interest and develop, you know, improve their health and well-being. So that policy is very much at the heart of it. In terms of the budget overall for the event is 50 million. Of that, 8 million is for the Cycling Facilities Fund. And that is about making sure that there are facilities in the local areas so that not just children, but everybody can, you know, sort of learn to ride their bike properly, can, you know, sort of practice their bike and, you know, have confidence in terms of using their bike on a daily basis.
Thanks for that. I'm just keen that extra money gets mainstreamed back into the culture budget for 2024. That was just pushing at the boundaries a bit. Thanks very much, Convener.
Thank you. I have a brief supplementary from Mr Ruskell, which I think is on the World Championships, and then I'll move to Mr Golden.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I mean, I think it's going to have a massive impact. I think that, you know, the improvement in facilities that will probably come to areas like Tweed Valley, Fort William as well are going to be incredible. But I think in terms of cycling governance, this might still be seen as a GB event. And I'm just wondering if that is the case, has there been any commitment from the UK government to support the World Champs in 2023?
So on governance, a special purpose vehicle has been set up as a wholly owned subsidiary of Visit Scotland to coordinate the delivery of the event. The SPV 2023 Cycling World Champions Limited are accountable to the Visit Scotland Board and to the 2023 Cycling World Championship Cabinet, which I chair. As has already been mentioned, we are providing £30 million over 5 years for the planning and the delivery of the event. Glasgow City Council is providing up to £12 million of funding, and UK Sport is providing up to £4.5 million. So there is funding from different places, but those are the governance arrangements in relation to the event. I'm trying to remember when I chaired the cabinet. I don't think there was anybody there from the UK government. There was from Glasgow City Council, from ourselves, from the cycling organisations, and from the special purpose vehicle who are managing the event. And I have to say, extremely proficiently, from what I was able to see.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Golden, to be followed by Ms. Minto.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, in October, you said the government was working on a cultural recovery plan. I wonder if you can give an update in terms of the timeline on when this might be published.
So this is the paper that I presented to the Scottish Government Cabinet in the beginning of November. That was the document where I think the key takeaway was, as we discussed at the beginning of this evidence session, was trying to ensure that culture and the arts is seen as a cross-government responsibility and opportunity. Now, so far so good, and started to work on that. I don't need to rehearse, you know, the fact that conversations are underway and all of that side of things. Obviously, we had the latest COVID variant that came along in the meantime, which has obviously had a huge impact on everything. So, has that had an impact on cultural recovery? Well, absolutely, because it meant that, you know, so many things needed to be cancelled in in December run into January, and we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that events have also been cancelled in February and March, and people have been putting off decisions until they have a greater sense of confidence about the health picture and about the risk of public health measures reoccurring. Now, we're all trying to do our best in understanding where we are in terms of our recovery from this latest variant. Good news, and I don't need to rehearse all of this, but you know, we should be pleased that we have done so well with the booster program. And obviously we had the announcement of the First Minister this week, and we'll see the reopening of venues from next Monday, which is hugely encouraging. So I think what was presented in November remains true, but it is something that we will now be able to action more, seeing that things have reopened, but we haven't been losing the opportunity, if you can call it that, the circumstances in recent weeks where we weren't able to see events take place, of making sure that the government's approach continues to be developed. You know, that is exactly where I'm at, is to try and make sure that we are at pace, doing everything that we can to help on the recovery side of things. Going back to the question, I think it was to Ms. Boyack in relation to flex in the budget. I'm very, very keen that the resources that we have allocated for remediation are importantly also for recovery, and so that once we know the scale of drawdown of various funds for the events, for things that were cancelled, for venues, for freelancers, that if we have any if we have any headroom remaining, that we're able to use that to springboard into a recovery phase. Now, you know, I'm open to suggestions about how can we give people maximum confidence, just as we've come out of the back of appealing to the public to be as cautious as possible. And I'm sure, you know, it's not lost on anybody. I mean, and we're not unique in this challenge. How is it that we can 1 week say to people, please only meet, you know, X groups of people in certain circumstances and not others, and then move to the next week and instantly say, you can go and do a whole lot of things that you were not able to do before. Now, some people will jump at the opportunity, and the overwhelming majority, I have no doubt, will be sensitive and will be careful about, you know, how they are in the company of other people. There will still be a group, though, and some of them, because of their personal health circumstances, will be such that they will be very cautious about wanting to go out for a while, perhaps. Now, I'm not sure I have the answer to all of this. I think we, you know, some of this area has become politicised in a way that things were less politicised at the start of the pandemic. You know, maybe that's just inevitable, and it reflects the fact that, you know, some people think that certain things should be happening faster than other people. Also reflects that some people are getting the advice from our official advisors and some aren't. I don't doubt that everybody wants the best public health outcomes. Don't doubt that for a second. But at the same time, there is a conundrum, is there not, about how can we now say, you've been cautious, now please go out and support culture and the arts by going to events. And we're just going to have to navigate our way through that, and we're going to have to appeal for people to be as responsible as they can be. But I know that the events organisers are hugely seized of all of that. And we already see, if we look at Celtic Connections, a really good example of an event which had circumstances not changed, had an entire festival in place to run in person. Then we had the latest variant, so they had to be imaginative about how much they could put as an online offering, and now they're able to have at least part of the programme be in person again. And you know, I take my hats off to everybody in the culture sector who is having been having to plan for any and every eventuality, And we owe them a huge debt of gratitude. And for us as supporters of the arts and culture, it's over to us. It's now up to us to support the events, the venues that we would traditionally have gone to, but maybe more than that. Maybe we need to be better about going to the things that we haven't gone to in the past. And there's a role for all of us, I think, as MSPs, as figures in the communities that we represent, to help give confidence to people, to help promote events that are taking place. And I think, you know, some collaborative working on this will make a huge difference. And I'm, you know, I'm keen to work with colleagues across political parties to work out how to do that. So over to you. If you've got any great ideas about what we need to be doing more of or less of or better, I'm very happy to hear that.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I think it's important, as you've recognised, the challenges of COVID. But in a previous submission to the committee, the V&A Dundee said that a multi-year funding settlement would be the single most important commitment the Scottish Government could make. I wonder, and I think you've recognised this, but I wonder if you could give me an update and the committee an update on the timetable for that implementation.
Yeah. So I'll signal again to Bettina Seislin that I'm about to call on her after I give you the first half of the answer and then give you the second half of the answer. So you're absolutely right. The V&A, and they are not alone. It's something that many organisations across the cultural community have said, if we could have multi-year certainty of income, it would just help inordinately in planning. And I think anybody that's had any dealings with financial management issues for an organisation will appreciate why that would be hugely advantageous. We understand that. We agree. And Creative Scotland is working on that. There will be further information forthcoming because this is something that is being worked on at the present time. So are we committed to doing it? Yes, we are. Is it being worked on? Yes, it is. Are we wanting to do it as quickly as we can deliver this through Creative Scotland? Absolutely. And at that point, I'll hand over to Bettina. But you know, your finger's on the pulse with this. We're on it and it is happening. Bettina?
Good morning again. So in terms of the multi-year spending review, we are looking at that currently, and we're going through an initial exercise to review what's required. In terms of the timescales for delivery, that we're intending that we conclude the review by mid-May. So that's the timescales currently. Clearly, we then need to look at Creative Scotland budget and we'll work with them alongside, but until we know what the overall settlement is, we won't be able to see what it should be allocated to organisations like the RFOs.
Yep.
Thank you, Bettina. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr Golden. I move to questions from Ms Minto to be followed by Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for coming to our committee, Cabinet Secretary, and your team as well. In previous evidence sessions and also previous meetings with you, Cabinet Secretary, we've heard about the success and vibrancy of the film and television industry in Scotland, not only the scenery, but also the increased studio capacity, the skilled people that work in it, the ancillary businesses around it. So I just wonder if the Cabinet Secretary could let us know how he sees this budget continuing to support an increased production in this very valuable industry to Scotland. Thanks.
Thank you very much for the question, and thank you for asking it towards the end of the evidence session, because if you'd asked me about it at the start, I'd probably have spoken for the entire session on this, because I'm, as I think I've shared with you, I'm absolutely passionate about what is going on at the moment with Scottish screen and TV production. There's a genuine revolution going on, if anybody's not noticed this. And I'm sure people, especially those in Glasgow, at this very time will have noticed it, given that Warner Brothers are filming Batgirl in the heart of Scotland's biggest city. We are seeing a growth, an unprecedented growth in the key building blocks of being able to aspire to being a significant centre of excellence for screen and TV production. The biggest single change that there has been relates to the opening of studios, which has allowed commissioning organisations from UK television, from the BBC, from Channel 4, from others, STV, through to the streamers of Netflix and Amazon and then the large commercial film producers, in the case of Backdoor Warner Brothers, to look at Scotland not just as a beautiful country which has the potential backdrop for certain types of films, which was traditionally the beginning and the end of people's consideration of filming in Scotland, but having studios, small, medium and large, well suited for producing series, well situated for producing big budget films and everything in between. And most recently with the Kelvin Hall announcement that we've had since I last gave evidence to you, which is a remarkable project that's happening in Glasgow at the present time, where studios are being built that will allow a certain type of television shows to be filmed there. Point is, with all of these studios coming online, incidentally, right across Scotland, and there are others who are thinking of opening more, in addition to that, we're seeing a proliferation of other parts of the film and TV ecosystem spring up. And now this has happened with the targeted support of Screen Scotland, part of Creative Scotland, supported by the Scottish Government. And we've had, for example, a production growth fund, which since it began in 2015, has, I'm just checking my numbers here, has a latest award of £9.9 million. Now, this has been worked out to have generated an economic impact in Scotland of more than £140 million, so a return of 14 to 1 on investment. So we are witnessing amazing things happening with film and TV production in Scotland. I think there's more than we can do, in particular on the skills side of things. We need to make sure that when somebody is thinking about producing a film in Scotland, that they know that they can draw down everybody that's required for such a production. And so I'm in conversation with colleagues in the Scottish Government and with external organisations about the skills pipeline that is required for screen and TV. Are we doing everything that we can to make sure that that's happening as it should? I should say, just as an ancillary point, also on the gaming side of things, for which there's an interrelationship with this as well. But you know, the question is well put. Are things being resourced from the Scottish Government to support this upswing in film and television production? To which the answer is unambiguously yes. We are very supportive of Screen Scotland. They have excellent people doing a great job attracting films here, attracting producers from elsewhere. Towards the end of last year, I spoke to independent European film producers, which Screen Scotland had brought to Scotland, and speaking with them, the number who were interested in coming and doing projects in Scotland. So, I mean, I just think we're now involved in a virtuous circle, and I think there are more things that we could do. Are there black clouds on the horizon? I think there are things that we need to be concerned about. I think we need to be concerned about threats to the BBC and Channel 4 at the present time. We've had the UK Culture Secretary, my opposite number, if you want to call her that, Nadine Dorris, announced this week gleefully the freezing of the BBC licence fee with an implicit threat that it may be cut entirely. And I think, regardless of criticism that you or anybody else might have about aspects of the BBC, and I do, They are a very, very important part of the commissioning ecosystem for film and TV, and I wouldn't wish to see that diminished. And the same goes for Channel 4, who, as committee members will know, have opened commissioning office in Glasgow as part and parcel of ensuring that there's a greater distribution of opportunity for film and TV commissioning in the nations and regions of the UK. And we have no guarantees that a privatised Channel 4 would even retain that. So yes, there's great news that things are on the up, but there's the potential for regressive steps if the UK government's ideologically driven attacks on the BBC and Channel 4 continue, and any influence that you could bring to bear as a cross-party committee to try and protect public service broadcasters and the commissioning of independence, especially through Channel 4, is something that we should all be working together and across parties to make sure that we are protecting as well as we can.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. A good point, very, very well made. Clearly, one of your passions is film and television. One of my passions is rural Scotland. And I also, given the debate that we had earlier this week about Scottish history being taught in schools and the importance of local museums, you've highlighted the cycling World Cycling event that will take across Scotland, and I think Scottish Opera have been highlighted as well as a touring company. So just a wee bit more information, if possible, about how you're ensuring that all areas of Scotland are being supported by the budget, next year's budget.
And is indeed a very important priority, for us. I asked for a list of the regularly funded organisations to be produced during the budget round as an illustration to ourselves and to colleagues across government that the impact of budgetary cuts in the culture sphere would have an impact right across Scotland and going down to very small communities, often in very rural and remote parts of Scotland, who are currently funded through the Scottish Government culture budget, and people were extremely alive to that. But you're right to say this is a priority, because what the budget and the different ways in which the organisations that are funded through it, Creative Scotland being the best example of which, and then the regularly funded organisations for which there are touring funds and there is a promotion of trying to get around the country to different bits of Scotland, is really, really important for us, really important for dealing with issues of rurality and the attractiveness of different parts of Scotland. We now know that we have a population challenge in Scotland again, with a projected decline in population, so we need to make all parts of the country as attractive as possible for people to live. Culture is an essential part of our national life, so people should have access to it regardless of where they live in Scotland. And we are hugely supportive of making sure that what we do reaches local communities, deals with challenges of social inclusion, education, and that is hugely valuable. Funding streams through Creative Scotland allow regularly funded organisations, which are geographically spread across Scotland, to be funded. Core funding of the national performing companies enables them to tour the Highlands and Islands, the North East, support from Museums Galleries Scotland and the Scottish Libraries Information Council. That enables museums and libraries across the whole of Scotland to bid for grant funding. And Historic Environment Scotland is, of course, responsible for buildings right across Scotland, not just Edinburgh Castle, it's Urquhart Castle, and I could go on and on. So, will there always be a perfect sort of matrix for the whole of Scotland? I imagine there will be places that will say, well, we haven't had the Scottish Chamber Orchestra for a while, or we haven't seen anybody from Scottish Ballet, and we'd really like to see some of their stuff. And I know that these organisations are very keen to try and make sure that they can get to places, especially places that they haven't got to. And so, again, I say to you and I say to colleagues on the committee, if you have evidence of of places that have not been able to benefit. If there are gaps, I want to know about it. I know to know about it, but I want you to know and colleagues to know that Creative Scotland and ourselves, we pay great attention to trying to make sure that Scotland's cultural offering is available to everybody in Scotland, right across Scotland, and we will continue to do that. And anything we can do to enhance that is very important to us.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I invite Mr. Cameron?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the Cabinet Secretary. Welcome again. You've touched on this already. You've been asked questions about this, but if I could just persist a little in it. One of the objectives for many cultural organisations, both large and small, urban and rural, will be getting the public back into museums, cinemas, galleries, theatres, live shows, etc. And I entirely agree with everyone doing their bit to help encourage that. But just in terms of funding, has the Scottish Government earmarked any specific funding for that kind of endeavour going forward?
Yes. Well, this is what I was saying to one of your colleagues just a moment ago about having budgetary flex of moving from a position where we were dealing, I'm talking now specifically. Sorry if I'm not being this obvious, I'm dealing specifically with the latest funding allocation, £65 million, a very significant amount of money found at very short notice to deal with the immediacy of the cancellation of events, impact on cultural organisations and on individuals, including freelancers, a gap in previous rounds for some people, which we wanted to close. And for me, that resource is also there to help these organisations as we rebound. Now, we're at the start of this because it's next week that things are going to begin to reopen. And I think there are things that clearly, from a budgetary point of view, we could look at doing, and I'm very open to doing that. Incidentally, again, I say to you and I say to committee members, if you have strong views on this, please share them with me. Please tell me what you think would make the biggest difference. What I do know is that we are working very closely with the cultural sector. There are my colleagues in Creative Scotland and Scottish Government are talking with people on a daily basis about where they find themselves, about how quickly we can get funds turned around, and then part of the next stage of conversation is how we can help springboard back to success. How we can, so there's the venues and the cultural organisations side of things, and then there's the sort of wider societal piece of how do we encourage take up and support of what is going on. And I think there is an opportunity for collaborative endeavour in this regard. Will it involve money along the way? Undoubtedly. Are there things that we can do to encourage people to go to events and shows? Yes. Will some of that be paid for? I imagine through the conventional routes of advertising and all of that. Absolutely. Should we be doing that? Yes. But can we be working, for example, with Scottish newspapers? Can we work with social influencers? Can we work across the panoply of communication opportunities to try and make sure that we're getting the message out there that people should be supporting the events as they come online? Absolutely. Is there a master plan? Well, we are thinking great thoughts, and we are working with our colleagues in the cultural sector, because, of course, they will be doing their own work promoting. I mean, I've already seen it, the Nutcracker being available to see again, Celtic Connections being back online, and so on. And they are advertising themselves. But I think there is a wider sort of national effort that we could and should be making to try and encourage friends, families, people in our communities to support things as they come back online. And you know, suggestions that people have about how we can be best doing that, please forward them on a, well, more than a postcard, but you know, I know where you are, and you know where I am. So please let me know if there's anything that you think we should be doing doing more of.
So thank you for that answer. I mean, one issue that cropped up locally was the decision of local authorities not to allow children, school groups, to visit the various cultural organisations. Now, there may well be a public health element to that, but as that hopefully diminishes, I mean that is, I think, an area of where we can sort of start to whether financial or not, but start to incentivise people to. Local authorities, for example, working with the Scottish Government to try and change that kind of approach.
I think that's right, and it's we've never really found ourselves in this position before, have we, as a society? I mean, not certainly since the Spanish flu. About how does one give people confidence as quickly as one can, whilst emerging from very strong public health advice that is very well founded on scientific advice on how we should interact and do so safely and be mindful of other people's safety and health concerns, and how do we at the same time encourage people to go out and socialise and be in the company of others, and is that a thing that will come naturally to everybody immediately? I don't think so, for the simple reason that there will be some people who have underlying health concerns, and so we'll be reluctant to be at the front of the queue to re-embrace the opening of venues and events and so on. But I think we're just going to have to do our best to try and reach as many people as possible, to give people confidence, to give the organisations, give the artists, to give the companies as much assurance as can possibly be given, that if we believe that the health picture is improving, that because of vaccination and boosters, the risk of mortality and so on, I don't need to go through the full explanation, you and other colleagues know this on the committee. I mean, there is an extent of trying to square a circle in all of this, and I think we're just going to have to try our best to try and give people confidence, and I think we can all play a part in this. We can ourselves be supporting local performances, local performers, local events. We can be making the point that we're going and encourage others to do so. And I think that's a good start. But you're right, there is a budget there, and it is not just there, although it's very importantly there, to deal with cancellations for loss of earnings from December and through to March, incidentally. But it's also having resource in place to make sure that we can help publicise the events that are taking place in 2022. And there are absolutely amazing cultural events planned for 2022. There's something there for everybody, and we should be going to as many of them as possible. I might see you there.
Well, thank you. I hope that my family trip to the Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe next month maybe an occasion. Can I ask a totally different question? And by all means, if you like, Cabinet Secretary, bring in your officials. It's about the budget for the National Records of Scotland, which has, I think, over the last 3 years, diminished in terms of the figures, and I just was wondering why that was. I think of it, looking at the budget itself, it's a diminution in operating costs, and I just wondered what the explanation for that would be.
Yep, I'm going to defer to Bettina Seisler on that. I suspect it's something because of the technical nature that it's probably best that we send you some detail in writing, Donald, which I'm happy to do. Bettina, is there something that you can add?
Thank you, Mr. Robertson. I would agree with you. I think it's better that we reply in writing so that we can provide the detail requested.
That's fine with me. Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I'm not seeing an indication of any further questions from committee. However, they do still have an opportunity, as I have a final question, Cabinet Secretary, for you. You mentioned libraries in your answer to Ms Minto, and as Ms Boyack had said earlier, we attended the cross-party group on culture and communities last night and heard from one of the cultural allios in Scotland about the support that their library gave to elderly people that they knew would be in isolation, and how they were able to continue a service, and how they did things like move BookBug online for younger members. So I would just wonder if you could give us a little bit of information about the support you're giving to libraries and their future and their recovery.
Okay, well, I'm mindful of time, convener, so I'll limit my contribution to say that funding has been provided to ensure the libraries can continue in the vital community role they play. I was reading, for example, in this morning's Herald newspaper about the reopening of libraries in the city, which I think is hugely heartening. And this, of course, is something that has been facilitated and supported by Scottish Government funds. And I do think, though, that there is a there is thinking that is ongoing and needs to be ongoing about the changing opportunities for libraries as community centres, as places that bring people in. Not everybody's reading in the same way as they were reading decades ago, and people are accessing information and they're accessing books in different ways. I do, however, believe that there is still a demand, a requirement for places where people can go and that they can access books and information. So the funding has been provided through this recent period to deal with the challenges that have existed, especially in some parts of the country. Yeah. But at the same time, I think it behoves us all, and I know that people in local government are thinking about this as well, in the library service, how is it that we can provide the best library network that we can for society in the 21st century, which is consuming books and other written material in different ways, and we need to be responsive to those demands. So there you go. That's my answer at this stage. But if you're needing more specific issue about if you're needing more information specifically about different budget lines in relation to libraries, we're happy to provide that to you.
Thank you. And I do see an indication of a final question from Ms Boyack, please.
Thanks very much, convener. I will keep it swift. It was just to draw the Cabinet Secretary's attention to the excellent evidence we had in last week's committee about international development expenditure. And one of the key themes that came across was the importance of well-being and sustainability legislation coming forward, and basically a plea to have a much more joined-up approach to international development expenditure. So I don't want to trigger a whole new conversation on that today, but it's really to say that that was something we took evidence on last week, and I hope the Cabinet Secretary will be able to pick that up in going forward in terms of funding and in terms of approach for the Scottish Government to international development funding. Thank you.
So just as a brief response, and I know that I'm taking you over your time limit, so I'm sorry about that, but in answer to Ms Boyack's question, you will have noted that we are increasing the funding on the international development side of things, but I'm very keen to draw my colleagues' attention to the evidence that you received on this issue, because we want to be as joined up as possible, and I want to be as informed as possible about the evidence that you've received to make sure that we're doing everything that we can in the most sustainable of ways. Thank you for drawing my attention to that, and I'll make sure that both my officials in this area and myself are fully cited on the points that were raised. Thank you for that.
Thank you very much. I think that concludes our consideration of the agenda item this morning. And can I thank the Cabinet Secretary, Mr. Whiteman and Ms. Sisland, for their time this morning. And I now move to agenda item 2, which is a decision on taking business.